I will talk about the talk is based on some joint works with Bogoslav Zagorodnitsky, James Inglis, Slava Futorny, and Wolfgang Vock. I will start in the talk. I'm going to talk 1 second. I'm trying to get the full screen. Wait a second. Okay, right now I have it. So I'm in this talk. I will discuss certain algebraic structure which appears in the theory of conservative interacting particle systems. The structure actually has a name. It's Jordan-Schwinger map, or rather some extension of it I'm going to discuss. And then I'll show how the structure, which comes from analysis, has application in algebra and also in mathematical physics. So in the first part of my talk, I will very quickly discuss interacting particle systems and how this structure came to light. Then I will, at least for me, then I will talk about the structure for in the case of Lie algebras and some applications of the structure. And in the third part, I will talk about the analog of the structure for the topological algebras and some further applications and open problems. So let us start with a very quick introduction into the theory of interacting particle systems. So we have the following setup. We have some configuration space X, which is usually R to the power of the lattice or some discrete set in the power of the lattice. We have some energy function. We assume that in equilibrium is described by the Gibbs measure, which is formally given by this formula. And the evolution is described by some Markov sim group with infinitesimal operator L. And the Gibbs measures are invariant measures for the same group. And the questions of interest is in the theory is the rigorous proof that measures are invariant, that the system is ergodic, and the rate of convergence to equilibrium. So right now I'm going to talk about a couple of methods to prove ergodicity of the system and find the rate of convergence to equilibrium. I'm going to talk about conservative interacting particle systems, which is usually doesn't have a spectral gap, and so they converge to equilibrium polynomial. And there are two well-known approaches. One approach is through function inequalities. This is some generalization of Poincaré inequality. If V is constant, it's just Poincaré inequality. Otherwise, for general V, it's known as a Nash inequality. Best example of it was derived by Nash, was given in the paper of Nash in 1956, I think. And so if you have Nash inequality for our infinitesimal generator and we have uniform bound for the semigroup, then you can prove that you have a polynomial decay. So this is one method which was used to prove polynomial convergence to equilibrium. And the second method is based on finite dimensional approximation. We can see that we restrict our lattice to the box. And then inside of the box, we have a finite dimensional operator and we study spectral gap of that operator depending on the size of the box. And then if you have some estimates on the spectral gap, then we can get in the limit polynomial convergence to equilibrium. The example when it works is given for the following operator, which is called Ginzburg-Landau process. So these are well-known methods. And now I'm going to present the problem which I have encountered. We have the following infinitesimal generator. So we have here sum over neighbors in the lattice of the squares of the rotations. You can see the xi derivative with respect to xj minus xj derivative with respect to xi. if you reformulate it in the polar coordinates, it will be angle between xi and derivative with respect to the angle between xi and xj. And the corresponding infinite system of stochastic differential equations will be the following one. I have written it for simplicity when the lattice is one-dimensional. So this system appears in the theory of heat conduction. Actually, it appears in three areas: heat conduction, stochastic fluid mechanics, and quantum spin chain models. But I'm going to talk mainly about, I'm going to mention only here heat conduction. We have a physical interpretation that we have a set of atoms. Each atom is characterized by its momentum. The square of momentum is an energy. Operators x, I, j, which are rotations. Derivative with respect to the angle, of course, conserve local energy. And you can easily see that total energy, at least formally, is also conserved. So the operators describe the exchange of momentum between atoms xi and xj. Formally speaking, we can see that invariant measures should be of this form. They will be Gaussian product measures parameterized by the temperature. What we can see that we have here non-trivial Lie bracket, at least when we take neighboring operators. So you see each operator acts only on two variables, xi and xj. So if two operators are near to each other, they will not commute. Also, we can see that Hermander condition is violated. So in the point zero, all operators are equal zero. So the system is quite degenerate. For that reason, of course, in this situation, it was not known any inequality like Nash inequality. So there is a problem to apply the fast approach. And of course, and another problem, even if we were able to prove the Nash inequality, is to get a uniform estimate for the same group. It's also not clear how to do it. And for the second approach, if you restrict on the box, we would get the degeneracy and we have a conserved quantity, the energy, local energy, and then we don't have any spectral gap. Also, I suspect that the second approach is applicable, but for a moment, I don't know any reference. Okay, so this is the system. And the first thing which is required is to prove that this invariant measure is really in that Gaussian product measure is invariant measure, proof rigorously, and the proof actually is quite simple. It's based on the Trotter formula, infinite dimensional Trotter formula, and the representation of the generator as a sum of two operators with simpler structure. What we do here, we notice that, let us look at the case when n dimension of the lattice is one. So we have here operators xi, the xi plus one minus xi plus one di, and we divide that sum. So we have only one summation set, j is equal to, we can assume, equal to I plus one. And then we divide it in the sum of even atoms, atoms with even number and with odd number. And noting that each operator acts only on the neighbors, we can see that in each sum, we will have a sum of commuting operators. Then of course, semigroup generated by the sum of commuting operators is a composition of semigroup generated by each operator. And so for such a semigroup, it's quite easy to prove that the measure is invariant. And then we can use Trotter formula, some infinite dimension version of the formula to prove that the Gaussian measure is invariant. Okay, afterwards, let us go to ergodicity. The theorem the main lemma, which is the crux of the proof, the core of the proof, is the following lemma. If we estimate norm of the gradient in the direction I of the semigroup, then it converges polynomially to zero. And it's easy to see, if we take it as a function xi square, it's easy to see that this is the optimal rate of convergence. And the idea of the proof is the following one. So we start to, this is more or less standard equality. We can see the difference between gradient of the semigroup in the direction, derivative in the direction I of the semigroup, minus semigroup applied to the square of the derivative in the direction f. And what is important here, when we write this equality, then we have this term VIPS commutator between derivative and the infinitesimal generator of the system. These terms are good because L is the sum of squares of vector fields, so this will give us some good terms. And the main problem is this term. And then, using the fact that derivative in the direction and the operator of rotation has the following the following form, we could calculate this commutator and prove that if we denote, if we introduce the function of time and the direction, so the function is actually measure of the square of the gradient in direction I of the semigroup. If we introduce that function, then in the end we have the following inequality, that f at the time t is less than equal initial condition plus this is a discrete Laplacian acting on the direction I. So integral of the coefficient, discrete Laplacian acting on that function f. From here we immediately follows that f of t is less than equal the semigroup generated by the discrete Laplacian acting on initial condition. And writing down this explicitly, we immediately get the result, we immediately get that lemma. Using that semigroup generated by discrete Laplacian converge to zero polynomial. Okay, so, and this is the structure which we consider. But first of all, I'm going to say some consequences of this lemma. As a result, using we can get a polynomial convergence to equilibrium, actually in strong H1 norm. So in the norm of the Sobolev space of order one, and we have of course from here immediately follows from Poincaré inequality for Gaussian measure. That we have that the system is ergodic with polynomial rate of convergence. And as a consequence of that corollary, we get a infinite dimensional Nash type inequality. So here is the two versions of it. We look at the second version, we could see that this is actually analog of finite dimensional Nash inequality. Here it's written. And you can see we have the same exponents here, but here n is the dimension of the space, while here n is the dimension of the lattice. And while the finite dimension equality is an L2 space in Rn, the A here is norm in Sobolev space of order one with respect to Gaussian measure. And so basically what happens when we go to infinite dimensions, that instead of L2 appears naturally Sobolev space of order one with respect to Gaussian measures. Here is a scalar product of L of f with f in that space. And that beta of f is analog of L1 norm. So it will be norm in Sobolev space W11 dimension with respect to Gaussian mesh beta. It's written here. So, Okay, actually here there is a open problem. What happens when to show that there is a limit when dimension converges to infinity? Why it's interesting? Because the constant here converges. Beta formally disappears, and we will get the Poincaré inequality if you consider infinite dimensional lattice, at least on formal level. And another open problem is when we consider more advanced heat conduction models. It is written this model as a system of stochastic differential equations. And here is written formal generator of the model. So it's the sum of, as you can notice, this is exactly the operator which we consider in the case of one-dimensional lattice, but it acts only in the variables p. And additional variables, p is the momentum, and variables q describe amplitude of the oscillator, and then we have some simplest system here, simplest Hamiltonian system. Then again, formally, it has again invariant measures, and the question of ergodicity of the system and the rate of convergence to equilibrium, it seems to be, for me, at least it seems to be open. I couldn't find anything in the literature. Okay, right now we can return to our algebraic structure, which I've written here. Here is the operator of rotation, derivative with respect to angle between the variables k and l. And then now we are going to consider some generalization of that. Of that algebraic structure, but first we need some definition of Jordan-Schwinger map. Actually, it was deduced around 80 years ago by Jordan, and it was used by physicists to represent, to construct representations of classical Lie algebras of matrices as an operators on the Fock space. Here, it's defined as follows. We take a matrix X and we define D of X as the following operator. Here is AI and AI joint will be boson creation annihilation operators. For the people, for the ones who does know what it is, we could realize it as operators of multiplication on XI, on variable XI, and joint corresponding derivative in the direction XI. And the important feature of this map is that first it's algebraic homomorphism, so it conserves Lie bracket. And secondly, in case of this realization, which is in the fine dimensional case is essentially unique one, we will get in the end a linear vector field. So now I can introduce certain generalization or as extension of the map. I introduce this without using boson creation annihilation operators for the simple reason to demonstrate here that it's a linear vector field. Of course, it could be, we could put here boson creation annihilation operators and actually fermion two. Okay, so how it's defined? It's defined, we will need some two topological vector spaces in duality with some B orthogonal systems, this generalization of orthogonal basis in the case of Hilbert space to the case of topological vector spaces. So we take some operator A, I alpha beta will be coefficients in that basis, in this B orthogonal system, not the basis, B orthogonal system. So you see the definition is quite similar. And what we need also, we need some extension. We define operators of derivative in the direction and the product in the direction, joint one. And then we immediately see that they will be, okay, for technical reasons, it will be, okay, it will be actually anti-homomorphism, but if you take a joint or minus, you will get a homomorphism, so it's. And then we have also derivative in the direction, a commutator with the of A will give us derivative in the other direction. And so We have that lemma. Actually, the second identity in that lemma is a more general case of our algebraic structure. So our Xij is actually image of D of the operator EIJ minus EJTI, where E is a matrix unit, so infinite matrix which has one at only the at EJ place. And the derivative will be opposed in that situation, will be derivative in the direction EI. So the algebraic structure which I have written before is a particular case of this identity. So what is important that this is in here that the D is a linear operator. By the way, this point of view immediately allows to generalize the result which was written before in the, for the quantum spin chains, because we could put instead of xi and derivative with respect to j, we could put creation, annihilation, bosonic operator, so we get the following operator. And then if you introduce some other basis, it becomes Hamiltonian of quantum spin chain. Actually, what happens in the case of fermionic creation annihilation operators, this is, I think, also open problem. Okay, so this one immediate advantage of this point of view. And the other one is that we can use the fact that this is algebraic homomorphism and compose it with a joint representation and give a representation of actually we could compose it with any faithful representation, and we immediately get a representation of arbitrary topological Lie algebra. By the way, the reason why I'm working in the setup of topological vector spaces is because the infinite dimensional algebras are not Hilbert spaces, while in many situations that topological locally convex spaces. So okay, so we get a representation of arbitrary Lie algebra by linear vector fields. If you use composition of D with a joint representation, it will be up to module, because we have a kernel coming from a joint representation. And if you have a composition with faithful, some other faithful representation, that would be also faithful representation. And furthermore, we have an embedding, we have using the fact that using the introduced operators of derivatives and the product in the direction, we have an extension of the algebra. We have some kind of embedding into the semi-direct product of linear differential operators. As an example of application of this result, we get a representation of Schrödinger Virasoro Lie algebras with linear vector fields. So we start with a Witt algebra with some particular representation of Witt algebra. And then we use Jordan-Schwinger map, and we use operators of derivative to make an extension in certain particular directions. And then we get a representation of Schrödinger-Virasoro algebra. That's one application, immediate one. And the other application seems to for me quite important is that we could notice that D of A is an operator with linear coefficients. So the semigroup corresponding, it will be basically semigroup corresponding to linear equation. So first of all, we have a connection between invariant subspaces of the operator A and the invariant subspaces one-to-one correspondence of the operator D of A. So what we do here, we take as a X as a space of endomorphisms of some ring such that derivative in the direction F of C is equal to zero, where F belongs to invariant subspace of greater A, and that space will be invariant subspace of D of A, and we could go in that direction. And furthermore, we have locally in time connection between semigroup generated by operator A and semigroups generated by operator D of A. And this is important because this corresponds to semigroup generated by operator D of A, corresponds to linear equation, while A, of course, even in simple situation, when we have first order operator with non-linear coefficients, we have a semigroup corresponding to non-linear equation. So example showing that this is only local correspondence is follows. This is a very simple example. So we take as A x squared dx, corresponding flow, of course, blow up. And then we could see that this the last corollary is equivalent to the following statement, that if you take en on the flow, here we take for a moment when n is there less than 1 over 2p, so we don't have here blow up. En is the orthogonal basis in L2, so it's sinuses and cosinuses, so on, is given by the following formula. And the part on the left is defined only locally before the blow up, while the part of the right, quite easily, you could see that this is defined globally because it's equal to sum of some antisymmetric infinite matrix minus P on the diagonal minus P identity. And it converges even exponentially to zero as they converge to infinity. So it gives us, we could see that formally speaking, we could extend in certain sense the solution beyond blow up. And it's open problem to understand this, even in this situation, it would be good to understand what's going on here beyond, in what exactly sense it expands it, it extends solution beyond blow up. So this is a case of Jordan-Schwinger map for the D-algebras. And now I'm going to talk about Jordan-Schwinger map for topological algebras.
Hi, Mikhail, we're into the question and answer session.
Okay, I will try to be very quick. So basically, I will just 2 minutes. So there exists analog of corresponding one, which conserves product instead of Lie bracket. What we do, we instead of creation and annihilation operators, we use mutually orthogonal isometries. And then you will get a conservation of the product, so corresponding construction. And then as an application, you could get that you will get a spectral theorem. The main point of that map that transfers operators on the locally convex spaces to the operators on Hilbert spaces. And correspondingly, we could get it conserves spectrum. We could get a spectral theorem. Of course, we get representations of algebras in this setup of topological algebras, and we get explicit formulas for finite dimensional algebras using explicit representation of Kunz algebra. So it will be instead of differential operators, it will be operator with weights. And it can be used for the quantization of finite dimensional systems. We use this map to produce a new type of quantization. So thank you for the attention. And here the list of unsolved problems. I will add here also here the literature. Okay. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker for a very nice comprehensive talk. Again, are there any questions which people would like to pose?
Recording stopped.
Stage? I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, Luigi.
Yeah. You mentioned that you have a representation of the Virasoro algebra. Can you show this again?
Yes. Schrödinger Virasoro, not exactly Virasoro algebra. It's not a.
Yeah, I want to understand what is this difference. between
Schrödinger
and Sarnia.
Okay, he is again. Okay,
he's very small. I cannot see any. It's so very, very small. Can you enlarge?
I'm trying. I already made full screen. Okay, maybe I will go outside of full screen and make it 300. Is it better? Oh, yes.
Okay.
Let me go again. Okay, where is the view? I cannot see the. Ah, okay, hit again. Let me go 400. Okay, here is the algebra. So we have some like V algebra, and we have some other operators also, epsilon operators. So the first L is like which are commutated between L and L operators and epsilon operators given like that, and between themselves they're commuting. So.
So from where this algebra comes? I mean,
it comes from statistical physics.
Is it true that if you put y equal to zero, you get Virasoro algebra?
No. If y is equal to zero, you get Witt algebra. So
the Witt algebra, not the Virasoro algebra.
Virasoro algebra. This is not Virasoro. You'll get Witt algebra.
And has this algebra a non-trivial central extension like the Witt algebra?
Okay, it's no, it's not a central because there is only one central extension of Witt algebra. This Virasoro algebra.
That is Virasoro. Yeah,
Virasoro algebra.
I ask if this algebra.
This another extension of Witt algebra.
Yes, but I ask if this algebra that you call Schrödinger-Virasoro has itself a non-trivial central extension.
Okay, it's a okay. You can say that no, it's not a central extension because epsilon is not commuting with 1 second. Epsilon is not commuting with L.
I was not asking if
it's an extension.
I was asking if this algebra itself has a central extension. That was my question.
That I don't know. It's
clear that.
Yes. That I don't know if it has central extensions. That's a good question, actually. Very good question. I don't know that.
Okay.
We'll have a look.
Thank you.
Okay, I think time's moving on, so let's thank the speaker again.